Welcome to ASHA's IAS Institute. This is our website www.asha.com. We upload current affairs here daily. So for the month of November too, I want to tell you that we have uploaded the compiled version of all the news, the editorials and the questions as two assignments. This has been uploaded since last 4-5 days. If you have been aware and have downloaded the PDF, great. Otherwise, you can download it now. Looking at current affairs for December now, the present day, that is 12th December. First, we look at the news. So, the news item also here in December, we upload news, the video links also and the PDF of the entire news editorial question bank dailies, which you can download. The news for 12th December, we have picked up 13 news items from the Hindu newspaper today. We'll discuss them in detail. The first one. Red Sanders task force set to go tech savvy. So this is Red Sanders anti-smuggling task force in Andhra Pradesh, which is developing a software with the help of a Hyderabad-based IT company. This is smugglers identification number system. So this will be used through a smartphone. So the task force personnel will take the thumbprints of any person who is apprehended in the forests. And then through this, it can be understood that the tracing of that person can be done through the database, which will give a clear idea of whether the person is a woodcutter or a smuggler, is having cases earlier, is a repeat offender against him. So this all will come out through this software. So this is the development being done, becoming tech savvy. But then what is more important for us is to understand what is Red Sanders. So Red Sanders is also called red sandalwood. So this plant is endemic to the Eastern Ghats in India. So it's found in southern Eastern Ghats in South India. It is different from the sandalwood, the santalum sandalwood tree, which is the aromatic wood for sandalwood wood, which is known for and is much in demand for and is smuggled as well. So Red Sanders is also smuggled, but it is not aromatic and it is in demand for its rich red color that its wood has. So this is the difference between the two, and both are found, similarities that both are found in South India and they are native. Endemic means they are native, they are originally from here, this region. Then the next news item is white flies plaguing coconut plantations in South India. So this rugose spiraling white fly was first detected in India, in South India, in two districts in Kerala in July 2016. Then a morphological and molecular identification was done. Morphological means the structure, the framework of its physical framework. So that identification and molecular based identification was done of this insect, and it was confirmed that this is the rugose spiraling white fly, which is native to Central America. So it was first found in Central America too, in Latin America in 2004. So it's there in these countries like Belize, Guatemala. It is found in the southern part of USA too, in Florida. So here it has a lifespan of only 40 days, and it is affecting the various species here. First time in 2016 found in India as well, and it is affecting the coconut plantations. Also using pesticides on these plantations, on crops affected by white flies, is counterproductive because it results in the death of the pest, this green lacewing, which is the natural predator of the white fly. So it eats up the white fly. So if you use pesticides, chemical pesticides, then this green lacewing is also killed. So rather than using chemical pesticides, it's required that biological pesticides, biological agents like starch powder, neem spray are used to treat these plants to ensure that white flies are also kept at bay. The next news item is a noble profession under pressure. So this is regarding teaching. So teaching at elementary level in public schools, in government schools, is having deficiencies. It says that there are structural deficiencies to, bureaucratic deficiencies to. So that means quantitative as well as qualitative deficiencies are clearly visible. So they are mentioned as teachers shortage, not a sufficient amount of teachers are there. There are vacancies, local politics, in enrollment of teachers, to corruption in transfers, the training defects, they are not well trained, socio-cultural factors affecting teaching, like caste division, cynical attitudes towards the profession. So all these have to be addressed. So qualitatively, level of teaching also is affected because of teacher absenteeism, means teachers stay absent for long, a culture of proxy teacher, somebody else is sent as a replacement for the actual teacher, subcontracting. So the teacher himself asks somebody else to do the job. So that is called subcontracting. Appointment of untrained teachers, because there is a vacancy, huge number of seats vacant, and there are not sufficient eligible teachers found. Then untrained teachers are also taken to these posts, and they are paid very low too. They don't have any security of their job, but then they are also of untrained category. So that also affects their performance. Long distance posting, so government school teachers have to travel long distances, so they are not well motivated enough. Lack of motivation, poor accommodation facilities, non-academic duties given to the teacher. So some schools do not even have staff to perform the work, then the school teachers are only supposed to do all staff work, so that affects their teaching. So non-academic duties affect their teaching, and political pressures. So these points are noted out, how teaching in government schools is affected in India. So the next article also, there are two articles in the Hindu newspaper on education today, and they are going to run a 7-day series. So yesterday too, there was one two articles again today, and for the next 5 days, again, there will be articles on education, which we'll discuss. The next is on the same issue, heavy cost of policy that neglects educators. So it talks of shortage of teachers in primary and upper primary levels in government schools. Uttar Pradesh has the largest deficit, and this teacher recruitment is entangled politically. So political pressure, political influence is seen in this aspect. In UP, what they have done is they have appointed Shiksha Mitras, who are contractual teachers. So these contractual teachers are trained poorly, paid less, and have little accountability and very few rights. So an example is also given of a contractual teacher who was paid 3,500 approximately a monthly salary, and once he became a permanent teacher, he would get around 30,000 per month. So you can see the difference between the salaries of contractual teachers and the actual appointed teachers. So full-fledged appointed teachers. So this was the point, contractual teachers, Shiksha Mitras, which are appointed because the UP government says that there are not sufficient teachers available, so there are vacancies, so we are going ahead with this Shiksha Mitras concept, contractual teacher concept. This was challenged in the courts. In 2015, Allahabad High Court nullified all these appointments because they are not eligible, because they have not passed the teacher eligibility test. Then how can they be appointed? So they are not up to the mark. So now these teachers' training, teachers' quality of the teacher education has to improve, and that is where work needs to be done. So there are training institutes too. There are block resource centers, cluster resource centers, there are DIETs, District Institutes of Education and Training, but they are virtually non-functional, so they don't function effectively. So here work needs to be done so that then it is be possible that government schools also become attractive rather than the private schools where the preference has been shifted these days. So that these are the points highlighted. The next news item is ISRO signs first contract to build 2 satellites. So Indian Space Research Organization's ISAC, ISRO Satellite Center, has signed a contract with a consortium, a group. Consortium means a group of companies led by Alpha Design Technologies Private Limited. So this consortium will help in AIT, that is assembly, integration and testing of 2 navigation satellites in the next 18 months. So this is the contract which has been signed, means ISRO has for the first time outsourced work to the private sector. So that is required. Earlier too, we have discussed in news that ISRO chairman has been repeatedly saying that the demand for satellites in India is much high, and the capacity which we have presently in the public sector with ISRO itself is not sufficient. So private sector has to come forward and take up assignments in this direction, and this is the first private contract which has been first contract with the private sector which has been signed by ISRO. So this is in news. So Alpha, it's a defense manufacturing contractor, and presently to all other companies in the consortium are already supplying components to ISRO's programs, but this is a full-fledged contract being signed now for development and assembly of a satellite. So this is the news. So the another news which is added up in the end is that a 7-satellite Indian regional navigation satellite system is already in orbit awaiting formal operations. So the chair has also spoken about this, the chairman of ISAC. So what is this Indian Regional Navigation Satellite System, IRNSS? So this IRNSS comprises of 7 satellites, out of which 3 are geostationary and 4 are geosynchronous. So these are shown here. What is the difference between geostationary and geosynchronous? I'll explain in a little while. So this IRNSS system is same as what we have as GPS, Global Positioning System, but it is regional. So this is a regional navigation satellite system. So GPS is open. Anybody can access it. And GPS has been developed by USA. And it has kept it open. But then there is no guarantee how long it would stay as an open source. Anybody can use it. USA can anytime stop its usage. And also GPS has both civilian and military applications. So military applications are exclusively used by US only. And civilian applications, whatever are there, are open to all countries, all people throughout the globe. So this we are using and we were using. But then during the Kargil war in 1999, it was realized that when the Pakistani forces came to Kargil, which is in Indian territory, we asked USA to give us their GPS location, but USA refused to do that. So India at that time realized that for military applications, this technology is very much handy and beneficial. So it is good that we develop our own technology and depend on that rather than having full dependence on a US technology. So that is when the IRNSS concept was initiated, and we have already developed the satellites, already placed them in orbit. What is presently required is formal operations to begin. So that will take place soon. So this regional navigation satellite system also covers the entire India and also 1500 kilometers beyond Indian territories too. So that's why it can be used to provide these services to regional countries as well. So this will also be done. The GPS receivers will not work for using this IRNSS services. So for this, special receivers are needed that are also developed. Now, as we saw, the 7 satellite system of which RNSS is composed, 3 are geostationary, 4 are geosynchronous. So what is the difference between these geostationary and geosynchronous orbits of these satellites? We'll see. So a satellite which has a geosynchronous orbit, so these geosynchronous satellite, this is one of the example of a geosynchronous orbit. This is a geostationary orbit. Geostationary orbit is a special type of geosynchronous orbit, and it is unique. This one orbit is geostationary, which is also geosynchronous. So geosynchronous orbits can be of different variations. So what is the difference? Basically, geosynchronous. Synchronous means synchronizing with one day. So the time frame taken by the Earth to complete one rotation about its axis, that is one day, complete whole day, which we know in general as 24 hours. But actual day, actual time is a little different. So that all adjustment is made, like we have a leap year. So it's not accurate. So that actual complete one day, sidereal day as it is called, is 23 hours 56 minutes. So this is the exact time which is taken by the Earth to complete one rotation about its axis. So even the geosynchronous orbit will be orbit around the Earth, whose orbital period, time frame taken to make one rotation around the Earth, is same. So that's why synchronous with a day. So it can have various inclinations. So all, it can be like tilted anyway. So all these inclinations can be, it can be anyway, this side, so geostationary is also one tilt, it is parallel to the equator. The orbital is parallel to the equator. So that way it can have any orientation. All are geosynchronous orbits. So geostationary is a special type of geosynchronous orbit that is circular and in the plane of the equator. So this is only one. There is only one geostationary orbit, and that is at a height of 35,786 kilometers above the equator. So this will be the orbit around which the Earth, around the Earth, in which a satellite will take 23 hours 56 minutes to complete one orbital. So this is stationary, it remains stationary. Any orbit here, any satellite in this geostationary orbit will always be seen stationary from the surface of the Earth. It will be always at the same position because it moves along with the Earth. So these are the two types of orbits. Next we look at US arms technologies come closer. So this is regarding the major defense partner. This designation has been conferred by USA to India through an act. So this is National Defense Authorization Act, which was passed few days back by the US Congress. We have already discussed then about this too. So this is US Congress. Congress means US Parliament. So this act will be signed by the president. Presently the president is still Barack Obama, so he will sign the bill and it will become a law. So this will provide major defense partner designation to India, which is for the first time that a country which is outside NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, and outside any treaty, without any treaty with the US, like ally treaties like USA has with Australia and Japan. We are not having any such treaty, so that still we have been given this status. So this will help in easing the acquisition of sensitive military technologies. So that will be the benefit for India. The licensing system would be simplified. The entire process would be institutionalized. So that is the benefit. India is have already put forth a tender for medium multi-role combat aircrafts. So we already have light combat aircraft and we have the Sukhoi 30 aircrafts, which are of superior quality. We need a medium range aircraft now, medium multi-role fighter aircraft. So this requirement is around, we require around 125 such aircrafts. And under this, we have put in a provision that it will have a significant technology transfer and make in India. So make in India in defense, as we have, means assembling and everything has to be done in India. So this will provide employment generation in India as well. So these proposals are part of it. So we are looking into which fighter would we pick up. So proposals have been put forth by many, like Boeing, Lockheed. These are two companies from USA. Their F-18 and F-16 fighter jets are in the fray, both respectively. Then Saab of Sweden has also put forth its Gripen fighter aircraft. So these will see which fighter aircraft is finally picked up by the government. It is said to be a single largest defense deal as such, for a single, you know, commodity required, defense equipment required. So this is the news. Next we look at zero import duty on wheat will lead to dumping unions. So the central government has recently announced that the import duty on wheat, which was 10%, will become zero now. So there will be no import duty on wheat. So government has done this to improve domestic availability and check rising prices of wheat and wheat based products. So this initiative has been opposed by the farmers unions and agricultural experts. They say that when the government says that there is no effect on the Rabi cropping season and the wheat crops have been sown sufficiently, then why will there be a deficit? Because during demonetization, that's what government claimed. So if there will be no deficit, there is a minimum support price which is announced. So minimum support price for this Rabi season was also announced. We have discussed it then too. That is the winter season, winter cropping season. So this MSP, minimum support price, is announced by the government, but many farmers are not able to acquire this. Government fails to acquire wheat crops from all the farmers. Then that results in distress sale. Farmers need money, they need to take this stock to go out of their farms. So then they have this distress sale under which the crops are sold at much lower prices than MSP in the markets. So when government is not able to assure this to all the farmers because of its own deficiencies in acquisitions, then by bringing in imports duties down, it will result in dumping. It will result in so much amount of wheat coming into the market, prices would go drastically low, and that would affect the farmers. So this initiative right now is opposed. Then the next news item is India must allow UN observer in Jammu and Kashmir. So this is UN military observer group in India and Pakistan, UNMOGIP. We have also discussed this earlier. So this UNMOGIP observers, UN observers, are not allowed in India. So India has asked UNMOGIP to wind up its operations in Kashmir in 2014. So this, and in 2016 earlier too, the Ministry of External Affairs has said that UNMOGIP has no mandate to monitor the situation in Kashmir. And when Pakistan refers to the issue of Kashmir to UN, it refers to this grouping. So now a Nobel Peace Prize winner of 1996, Jose Ramos Horta, who had played a major role in resolving the violence in East Timor. This is an island nation in Southeast Asia. So this, he was awarded this prize for this role in bringing in peace, resolving violence. He suggests that India should allow UNMOGIP observers, because it is only through impartial military observers that a crisis, a bilateral crisis, can be resolved. Otherwise, it would keep on escalating and the people would continue suffering. So this is his suggestion put forth. The next news item is IS recapture Palmyra after brief retreat. So this is Syrian city Palmyra, which is an ancient city having ancient heritage. This city was heavily under Russian airstrike, but then the Syrian army was not able to stay its hold here, and because Russia is supporting the Syrian government, so Syrian army is trying to capture this from Islamic State, but then Islamic State has been able to come back. It has recaptured Palmyra again. So that is the news presently. That brief retreat was what we saw, but then it went back to IS. So the fight in Syria is still going on. The next news item is time to leave history of coal behind. So this is, coal is cheaper than gas. Gas, natural gas, but then it is more expensive if you look at it holistically along with the externalities. So externalities, like it affects the health through the pollution, environment is affected. So if you look at health and environment cost, then it is significantly more expensive than gas, and gas is much more cheaper than in terms of health effects and as well as environmentally. So natural gas is 50% cleaner on carbon emissions than coal. So we should move towards natural gas rather than using coal. So this is a grouping, International Gas Union, which is a non-profit organization comprising of natural gas majors from across the world. So this chief is saying presently that there is a requirement that governments should bring in strict emission standards, and there should be an enabling regulatory framework, a high price on carbon through taxation, carbon taxes, so that natural gas is preferred and that market develops. So it says pipelines need to be constructed to allow gas to be transported. Third party access should be allowed so that sale of natural gas take place at the required level and it reaches the customers. So all these points are put forth. He says that India should also move towards increasing the share of natural gas. Presently it is only 6.5%. The government also has plans to increase it up to 15%. On an average, globally, natural gas percentage in an energy mix is 24%. So 24% is natural gas usage on an average. But in developing countries, it is generally seen that coal dependence is high. But then governments need to move towards better, cleaner fuels too, because as development progresses, then movement towards cleaner fuels is essential. So this is point put forth. Again, India is having domestic production of natural gas, but the demand has increased so drastically now that natural gas is imported as well. So now it has become an importer of LNG too. And it also says, this leader also says, that the renewable energies like solar energy has huge potential in India and has developed as well, but other renewable energy technologies, as long as they are not fully developed, investing in them becomes costly and redundant, because later the technology becomes ineffective. There are better technologies coming in, so we have to wait. This is his suggestion giving, that you have to wait till the technology is completely ready and then you provide subsidies for it. Otherwise, it is inefficient and costly subsidies for technologies that may be irrelevant in the near future. So that is one more point he adds up. The next news item is, we are ready to build Hyperloop transportation system in India. So this is a chairman of Hyperloop Transportation Technologies, which is a startup in Silicon Valley in USA. So he is in talks with the Transport Minister of India, Union Transport Minister Nitin Gadkari, and he says that we are putting up proposals to build Hyperloop transportation system in India. Now, what is this Hyperloop transportation system? So this Hyperloop concept was put forth by Elon Musk. So it is a public transport, passenger transport system. So it pushes a pod-like vehicle. So it's a pod, means like peas are in a pod, so pod like enclosed vehicle is pushed through in a vacuum. So that entire vacuum is created in a tube by suction of the air, and because of this, the speed, there is no resistance and the speed increases, so it can move as high as the speed of aircrafts too, and even higher. So these are much more efficient than high speed trains which will be developed. So they are much more expensive, and also there is less of profit in that technology, plus it is also energy inefficient. So there's huge amount of energy required because it in high speed trains it has to reach up to superconductivity level to allow the system to work. But in hyperloop system, it's a simple system and it can easily air evacuation takes place. So that is the simple technology you can see here. There is a compressor which sucks in the air so that there is a vacuum created, minimal resistance, and the pod can move easily. So these are done in an enclosed tube, low pressure. So it moves through magnetic levitation. So this is how the pods are powered too. So magnetic levitation is also used. Maglev trains are also there. So similar technology is used here too. Then the next news item is nanoceramic material for safer, cheaper nuclear reactors. So scientists, a group of scientists, of which one is also of Indian origin, have created a nanoceramic material. So this can be used in next generation nuclear reactors, which can operate at much higher temperatures and radiation fields, and therefore they will be producing much more energy and will be much more efficient and economical. So this new technology which has been developed is nanoceramic material. It will be used as a coolant because it can withstand harsh effects of radiation. So this material is such, and also presently the coolants used, like water is the primary coolant used in reactors, but then it has limitations too because the temperatures up to which water can be cooled is limited. The new coolants which are developed, like liquid metals, sodium and lead, liquid sodium and lead, which are developed as coolants, they are also able to withstand very high temperatures, but then they are also corrosive. So the nuclear reactor metal which is used, that are corrosed at very high temperatures by these new coolants. So water also has its limitations to reach up to very high temperatures. The new coolants developed also have its limitations because of the corrosive nature. So in such cases, nanoceramic material developed right now is much more efficient. So that is the development. What is a coolant? Basically, nuclear reactors need fuel coolants. So these coolants are there to absorb very high excess of high temperature. So these coolants are an essential part of a nuclear reactor. So they are also connected to energy generators and energy can be generated. So these are the coolants present because temperatures in reactors can go at very high, high. So then how to bring this temperature down? So this is the function of the coolants. The next news item, the last one, is Indian origin teens top science contest in US. There are three Indian origin teenagers in USA who have bagged this scholarship worth $2 lakh. So they'll be sharing, two twin sisters and one Vineet. These three, the technology twin sisters developed is a project which they have developed. So this is linked neurofuzzy interference system, a novel approach to schizophrenia diagnosis. So how to diagnose schizophrenia at an early stage? For that they have used neurofuzzy interference system. So neural technology and fuzzy technology used together. So what is this fuzzy system, fuzzy logic? We'll understand that, because this news item as such is not important. Nobody is going to ask you who won the award, how much award, but then what are these technologies which come forth? We need to discuss this. And another award was for a project put forth which was for developing an ingestible battery, a battery which can be ingested and that can transform the way doctors diagnose and monitor health problems. So that battery can give you the complete details. So this is a high performance biodegradable battery for transient electronics. So what is transient electronics? We'll understand that too. So two aspects, one is fuzzy logic, two concepts we'll discuss. So what is fuzzy logic? Basically is a many-valued logic, because logic generally what we understand is binary logic, means true or false, yes or no. So this reasoning goes into the approximate nature. So approximately, whether it's not fixed and exact, it's approximate. So levels of variations are allowed. So this is different from the traditional logic theory. That's why it's called fuzzy logic. So it's not two valued. You can see it has ranges of degrees and it has ranges of applications too. It is used in consumer devices like microwave ovens, washing machines, automotive devices like air conditioning, fuel control, emission control in automobiles. It is used in industries for food processing, packaging. It is used in decision support systems as well. So an example of how it is used to, like fuzzy logic in washing machine, how is it used? So in washing machines, the aspect is how to perform. So how much of washing is required? So for that, you have to have the detail and idea about how much the clothes are dirty. So there are sensors which are placed. So these sensors continuously monitor the varying conditions. So based on varying conditions, the functioning of the requirement is adjusted of the washing machine. So then it results in better cleaning to an efficient use to, means if they are not very dirty, then you don't need to wash them a lot. So that helps in bringing in efficiency as well. So it is having better performance, productivity, simplicity and less cost. So that's why fuzzy logic is generally used. The next point which was there is biodegradable battery, which is a transient electronic. So what is this transient electronics? Is a new class of electronics whose key feature is that they are designed to disappear completely without a trace in a controlled and programmable manner. So after a period of time, they'll have no trace. So that is called transient electronics. So such electronics is a new class developing now. So you should know about these terms. So that is it for today. Thank you.